Underwriting for the Money Doctor Show is provided by Ryan and Casey Liquors, Main Street, Greenfield. Exploring the world, one glass at a time. West County Equipment Rental of Shelburne. Daily, weekly, monthly rentals. 625-6463 or on the web at westcountyequipment.com. The Franklin County Community Development Corporation. Growing sustainable businesses and communities since 1979. www.fccdc.org. Weld Communications, Marketing and Publicity. Helping businesses spread the word in the Pioneer Valley and beyond. www.weldwords.com.
There's a better life if I could be debt free. But all my money is a mystery. I was feeling overwhelmed and it was wearing thin. When I knocked on the door and heard the doctor's in. Oh, the doctor's in, the doctor's in. She got the right prescription to help you win. Oh, the doctor's in, the money doctor's in.
Hello and welcome to The Money Doctor. I'm Dr. Frances Rahaim, president of Power Down Debt, a positive debt management company. And my guest today is none other than Lenny Zarcone, who is an entertainer of more than 30 years, everything from theater to mime to America's Greatest Songbook. So welcome, Lenny. Thanks for being here.
I'm happy to be here.
You're always happy to be everywhere.
Well, I'm certainly happy to be here. This looks like fun. I love your set, the colors.
Well,
everything
thank you.
Is just so nicely done.
Now, I have to say that when we were preparing for this, I had the hardest time just keeping you focused on let's just sit and chat, because you are a performer. I remember you wanted to play accordion, spin plates, juggle balls, all at the same time. And I said, I want to get to know the guy behind all of that, because we all see that persona when you're out performing. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to get to know the guy behind all of that, to sort of show that conversation with you can be as entertaining as entertaining. So tell me a little bit about
Let's hope so. I can be entertaining in just conversation.
Tell me a little bit about your
background. The most I could do is wave my hands around a bit, but not too much.
That's right, not too much, because we don't want to ding up that mic. That's right. So you're from Rochester, New York originally.
That's right, Rochester, New York.
How'd you get here?
I was born and raised there, and when I left for the first time, I was 17. I went to college down in Miami-Dade, mm-hmm. or Miami, Florida,
right.
to Miami-Dade Junior College, and that's where I got into theater.
Okay.
And from there, here, there, and a few other places, but I eventually ended up in Boston in 1980.
When
you were a little kid. And it was July 5th, 1980, my brother's birthday, the day after July 4th, and pulled into Boston after auditioning in Washington, D.C. for a mime company called the Pocket Mime Theater, and they wanted me.
When did you start doing mime, and how did that work?
When I went back to Rochester, I went to like three or four different colleges, in part because I didn't want to be typecasted.
Mm-hmm.
That was kind of my excuse, but you know, I'm a changeable, mutable person that, you know, wants to try different things. So from Miami-Dade, I went to Nazareth, and from Nazareth to the State University of New York at Brockport, and from Brockport, I went off to Niagara-on-the-Lake, Ontario, to study mime with the Canadian Mime Theatre.
Okay. The Kazoo Soliloquy.
Yes.
You won an award for that.
I won an award for Kazoo Soliloquy?
I thought you did.
I've won awards. Yeah. I don't know if it was specifically for the... Oh, no.
Isn't that the one with the baby in it?
Yeah, that's
the one I like. It goes on for like 20 minutes?
Well, 10 minutes.
Okay, maybe. 10 minutes?
I trimmed it down to about 5 for
right.
TV.
No. Well,
but the Kazoo Soliloquy was a part of my senior project where I'm singing a song through a kazoo and accompanying myself on the guitar in the style of like an old European clown with a beret, and he's kind
right.
of an old guy, and he's telling this story about his life. And the song was taught to me by a young woman around the block from where I lived in Rochester when I was a teenager, and it was Charade from the movie Charade.
Wa-da-da-da-da-da.
So I sing that through the kazoo.
Yes.
I tell this story about falling in love, getting married, having a baby, and a few other wild and crazy things happened during the course of this
life. Tell it, but you never use any words.
No, it's all through the kazoo, like,
right.
Right. You know, yeah.
It's also, yeah,
yeah.
Exactly.
And it's fun.
It is fun.
It really is a great... great piece, and
yeah.
one that I'm proud of that will go down in history books from
yeah.
like mime festivals and theater festivals and places where I've performed that over the years.
Absolutely.
But when you talk about winning an award, when I auditioned in New York City for an agency company, an organization called Affiliate Artists, Inc. of New York City, it was started by two opera singers, Cheryl Milnes from the New York, I was going to say ballet, no, the New York Opera.
Okay.
The American Opera Theater. Oh, gosh, I'm sorry, Cheryl, if you're listening. I'm sorry, I can't get the name right, but they started it, and every year they'd invite new young artists of different solo disciplines, and I auditioned for the mime discipline, and Kazoo Soliloquy was one of the pieces I did, and got in.
Oh, and maybe you know, that's
it's a nationwide audition, so.
Yeah. Interesting.
It wasn't an award, but it was quite an achievement. And then they send you to rural communities like Greenfield, and I met Bill Clinton when he was a governor, because they sent me to Pine Bluff, Arkansas, and I was in a parade. I had a white face, a top hat, a striped shirt, and I'm on the back of a farm truck doing mime.
Yeah.
Once the parade was gone, but while we were setting up, the sponsor said, "Would you like to be our governor?" And I said, "Sure." And there he was. And this man had an aura about him. He was an alpha male. He was a man, and she said to me, "You know, he's going to be president one day." And this was 79.
So if you've just tuned in, where my guest is Lenny Zarcone, we're talking. Lenny's talking, which is just what we wanted. So you've been an entertainer for more than 30 years.
My God, I'm old. Ah. Do I look old on camera? Can you see the wrinkles?
I can see the gray.
Is my baby bump showing?
But it, well, the well, baby bump, I don't know if you have a baby bump, that's a different show.
That is
then we have a medical
a kind
show.
Way of referring to a little bit of a.
You don't have a little bit of
I just have to be able to button my tuxedo.
When you're singing, when you're performing America's Greatest Songbook or whatever, you come dressed in a tuxedo. Which is a little
American
like getting
songbook.
A Barbie doll that comes with her own limo or whatever. You come
yes.
as the whole package.
Yes, so, in a tuxedo.
What did I say? Did I not say Great America
Songbook?
You're
saying
songbook?
American Greatest. It's the Great
oh,
American
Oh, I'm sorry.
Songbook. And I think we have to thank Rod Stewart for coming up, him or the record producers, when he started recording these songs. Mm-hmm. But prior to that, they've been referred to as jazz standards or timeless, great old timeless music where the lyrics are audible and they're poetic.
Yeah.
There are many, many crazy things that'll keep me loving you. And with your permission, may I list a few. The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. Oh no, they can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, they can't take that away from me. We may never, ever meet again on that bumpy road to love. Still I'll always, always keep the memory of the way you hold your knife, the way we danced until three, the way you changed my life. Oh no, they can't take that away from me. No, they can't take that away.
We were talking about the Wright Brothers, right?
With the Wright Brothers,
okay.
Yeah.
So tell me.
Tell me who the Wright Brothers were before I get us out of this half.
The Wright Brothers are, well, currently, the Wright Brothers are no more, really. Just two of us are left. Sam Kilborn from South Freeport, Maine, way the heck up and over there, and me, Lenny Zarcone, here. And we occasionally still do a Wright Brothers show. And we're even knocking around an idea. I hope two of them aren't listening. But Jody Scalise, the fellow who deserves credit for being the founder and the initiator, the inspirator, inspirational person who said, let's put together a group of these, a bunch of funny guys, you know, like the Three Stooges, like the Marx Brothers, like the Ritz Brothers, like the
So there was physical comedy, song, there was all this.
Lots
tell
of
somebody what
comedy.
A Wright Brothers show would be like.
Oh my God.
Like 1 minute. You have to tell us in about 1 minute
I'll
what a Wright Brothers show would
be. 18 seconds.
Okay, let's hear
We'd
it.
We'd start out with a little song. We come from different mothers, and like us, different fathers, like us, there are no others. We're brothers, that's the same. We dance around, and we do funny little moves, guys, we do handstands. Geez, that's my first 15 seconds. But anyway.
I just love that you did all that without getting out of a chair.
I know.
Because
I've
tethered you to that chair.
Joe, can I get out of the chair, please?
It's killing you, isn't it?
My leash is too short. But anyway, we'd sing. We'd juggle potatoes that we took out of our lunch boxes. What do you call them? Lunch boxes.
That's called a lunch box,
and we were like janitors. We had these janitor outfits on, and we'd juggle plungers. And
juggle plungers.
Plungers and potatoes, yeah.
Plungers like a bathroom plunger.
Yeah.
Juggled plungers.
Actually, they would. I was not
okay.
The juggler. My forte was more, hey, I'm stammering, was more like music, mime, and the other stuff, and comedy.
My mind is just reeling about who the first person was who looked at a plunger and decided it would be good to juggle.
Well, it's because, you know, here we were in the character of janitors doing a show. It was like a day in the life of these funny janitor guys.
Sure.
Okay. And we'd sing, but the thing that everybody remembered most, and it bugged us, because we wanted them to enjoy the whole show, which they did
right.
For the most part, but they always attributed us to this piece called The Race, where we would run in slow motion.
Oh, I love The Race, yeah.
And a fight would break out, and all hell would break loose to the music of Chariots of Fire.
Right.
We'd run in slow motion. And everybody would love that, and that's what they would remember. They'd say, yeah, but what about when we did the funny thing with the potatoes? Come on, we worked on that for a year.
The Race is great.
You know, one of the other things we did, which is an idea of mine, but I should also acknowledge Jack Golden, another one of the Wright brothers, and Gary Krinsky. So
okay.
It's Jody Scalise from Charlemont, Gary Krinsky, he lives in Greenfield, Jack Golden lives in Leiden, Sam Kilborn way the heck up in Maine, and me here.
Lenny Zarcone here in
Greenfield.
That's right.
But...
So,
Jack Golden
okay.
went to school and studied mime at Tony Montanaro Celebration Mime Theater. And while he was there, that's when they initially composed and co-wrote with a group of his peers that piece, which we went on to continue to perform hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times. And so.
Okay. So, we're going to stop there for a moment. I have to do a break, let our underwriters talk. And. When we come back, even though he'll still be tethered to this chair, we'll see Lenny Zarcone unleashed. We'll be back in a moment.
Underwriting for the Money Doctor Show is provided by Ryan and Casey Liquors, Main Street, Greenfield. Exploring the world, one glass at a time. West County Equipment Rental of Shelburne. Daily, weekly, monthly rentals. 625-6463 or on the web at westcountyequipment.com. The Franklin County Community Development Corporation, growing sustainable businesses and communities since 1979. www.fccdc.org. Weld Communications, Marketing and Publicity, helping businesses spread the word in the Pioneer Valley and beyond. www.weldwords.com.
I like New York in June. How about you? I like a Gershwin tune. How about you? I love a fireside when a storm is due. I like potato chips, moonlight motor trips. How about you? I'm mad about good books. Can't get my fill. And James Durante's looks, how they give me a thrill. Holding hands in the movie show when all the lights are low. May not be new, but I like it. How about you? I like New York in June. How about you? I like a Gershwin tune. How about you? I love a fireside when a storm is due. How about you? I'm mad about good books, can't get my fill, and Jimmy Durante's looks, oh, how they give me a thrill. Holding hands in the movie show when all the lights are low may not be new, but I like it. I like it. I like it. How about you?
Hello and welcome back to The Money Doctor. I'm here with my guest, Lenny Zarcone, entertainer extraordinaire for 30 years here in Greenfield, Mass. You have so much energy, but I want to get a little bit into the serious side of your background about how you ended up where you are now. You've been a physical comedian, you've done mime, you've done all kinds of stuff. But now you are singing
puppeteer
mostly.
Puppeteer, too. Didn't
and
tell
puppeteer.
You that.
Puppeteer. Now you're mostly singing,
yes.
Which is really kind of interesting. So, and a lot of what you do, although you do all kinds of music, is...
I would refer to it as the Frank Sinatra songbook. The jazz standards, the Great American Songbook, with very similar arrangements to those that Frank Sinatra utilized with great musicians, composers, and arrangers. And right now, as a matter of fact, a fellow by the name of Wes Brown, who's an upright bass, wonderful, world-renowned jazz musician. He also can play piano. He's a pianist, too. He studied as a kid. And he's coming back to the piano for this thing that we're doing together. And he's learning those arrangements. And the guy is just brilliant. And we just had a rehearsal yesterday, and I'm so excited about it because I had been working with pre-recorded backing tracks for a few years, and I've wanted to like put together a band. But so far, it's just Wes and I. Sometimes he gets on the upright bass, and sometimes I'll actually sit at the piano.
He's good on both instruments.
And there's a place called the Blue Rock Restaurant in Shelburne Falls that has this every other month through this whole year.
I can't say all of the stuff about Frank Sinatra without asking you for the story about being related to Frank Sinatra.
Okay. I believe it's true. I've been told by my Aunt Eileen, an Irish woman who married my Uncle Leonard when they met during World War II in England.
Uncle Leonard. Yep.
Yeah, and Uncle Leonard, he fought against Italians in Italy before the Italians changed sides and became allied with the Allies. But they were told this, as the story goes, by my Uncle Leonard's Uncle Frank Torello. And one of the reasons why it's hard to know for sure, are we really cousins, can I look it up, is because I can't seem to get the spelling of Torello right. T-I-R-R-I-L-L-O, one R, T-U-R.
Many names change like that, right?
And I give up quickly because I feel pretty certain and confident that what my aunt had told us that she had heard, and the way she heard it from Uncle Frank, great Uncle Frank Torello, he'd be like 120 if he was alive today. This was in the 50s, maybe right around the time I was born or just before I was born. They moved to California and they were taken out to dinner by Frank Torello, who was a prop master at Paramount Pictures. And my mom, when she referred to that uncle, she goes, "Yeah, he took care of the swords." And so I'm picturing
the swords.
The Errol Flynn movies.
Wow.
He's like the prop master dealing with the swords and other things. But he knew that my mother's grandmother and my Uncle Leonard's grandmother and Frank Sinatra's grandmother, one of his two, were cousins. And I don't know if it was first or second. It probably was very close to first, if not second. And I'm not sure what that makes me. But I feel it, you know, I feel like, you know. So
you're related.
Tina Sinatra or Nancy Sinatra or Frank Jr., if you're listening to this.
We think you're related.
It's very clear our love is here to stay. Not for a year, but ever and a day. The radio and the telephone and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. But oh my dear, our love's here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may crumble and Gibraltar may tumble, they're only made of clay. But Our love is here to stay. You know, I gotta say, this is kind of strange. Singing and performing in a empty television studio. Except for you, Sam. And I can see people in the booth. Hiya, Francis. That's Francis, sorry. The radio and the telephone and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. Hit it, man. But, oh my dear, love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may crumble and Gibraltar it may tumble. They're only made of clay. But our love is here to stay. See ya.
When we were prepping for the show, we were at the Shady Glen, and your neighbors came in and told me all kinds of stories about when they're home, they can hear you singing in the house. You practicing. Have your equipment, you're singing in the house, you're cooking, you're doing whatever.
Yes.
So you're always off the wall like that.
Yeah.
So transitioning from a mime artist and puppeteer and all of that into singing this greatest songbook, the America's greatest songbook, right? Am I right? Or greatest American songbook?
You just made me think of a song. You know this song, That's Life? I've been a puppet, a
right.
pauper, a pirate, a poet, a pawn, and a king.
That's right. Well, perfect.
I've never been a king, though. A pawn,
well, there's
yes.
time. There's time yet, Lenny.
Is there?
There's time.
I'm
okay.
60.
Well, ooh, you're going to have to find some new.
That?
You're going to have to find some new relatives
speaking
to get the king thing.
Speaking of being 60, I'm
yes.
hoping, like, Tony Bennett.
Yeah.
He's 85 now, I think. And 84. Yeah, he's at least 85,
right.
And he's still doing it.
Yep.
And he's doing it with enthusiasm and passion. And
yeah, he's still bringing the show.
Yeah.
Sure.
And I hope that I could maybe do that. You know, keep singing, keep performing.
I think that's part of what makes it so appropriate when you do these senior shows. So I want to talk to you about the seniors. But
okay.
Before we do, give us a little background about how you got turned on to this songbook. The mother-in-law, all of that stuff.
Well, you know, and growing up, I was like in 1960, I was 8 years old. And 65, I was, do the math, 8 and 5 is what, 13?
Well, I'm only the money doctor, I can't add that money. Don't tax me those big, big numbers.
But
yeah.
When the Beatles came out and I was 11, I was in love with the Beatles and all the music that came with that time and that era. But Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Perry Como,
right.
Bing Crosby, all those guys were there and they were doing it and I was aware of it and I'd catch them on TV and I wasn't drawn to it or attracted to it, but it was getting into my psyche. It was becoming that culture, that music that they were doing, it was familiar.
It was subliminal to you at the very least, right?
But now, and you know what? One other thing, I'm going to tell you about what my father said when I first got in the theater. I'll just say it really quick. He said,
"It's okay,
Leonard," or Len, he used to call me Len. "Len, take a look at Frank Sinatra. Take a look at his career. Look at what he did, you know." And that's something to emulate. Or
sure.
I forgot the exact words he used.
Yeah.
But and you know what? That was like 1975. It took
right.
to like 2005.
Yeah.
Which is what 30 years?
Yeah.
30 years later, I discovered this music because my mother-in-law moved in with us.
Hmm.
She came all the way over from Grand Rapids, Michigan. She was dealing with memory loss. And she lived briefly at the Arbors. Whoops, did I mess up the mic?
No, I think you're okay.
Puppet.
You're good. Okay.
The
back to the Arbors, yes.
Before she moved to the Arbors, she was living with us. And one day I thought, I knew that her and her husband, they were very social people. They had parties and cocktail hours, and this was their music.
Mm.
So I thought, I'll get a Frank Sinatra CD and I'll play it on the boombox outside while we're doing a barbecue. And she's swinging in a hammock, dozing off. And you know what? At this point, she couldn't remember 5-10 minutes ago what she had said or what we had done. The short-term memory was gone.
Right.
But she knew every lyric of the music, so I kept playing it for her. And I started to get to like it more and more.
Mm.
And then I started going into the living room and putting it on and singing along with it. And then I realized, oh my gosh, this is the next chapter. This is what I'm gonna do. I love it. I think I can do it. And it's been about 5 years or so that I've been singing this great music.
Favorite quote from one of the shows that you do at the senior centers, because aside from entertaining in typical venues, restaurants and mm-hmm. things like Magic Wings, we just had Magic Wings owner on the show, mm-hmm. You do these senior shows, which are really, yeah. I think, valuable.
I travel around to senior centers. Like at the Greenfield Grill, we did a special event where they came to us and had lunch and saw a show.
Right.
We may do some more of those. But I love
favorite
performing
comment?
For seniors. It's their music, and it's our music. It's part of our culture, but very much the music they grew up with. But when I go to do a show, I'm singing and entertaining, and I'm also doing a variety of the other things that I do to entertain them. And you want to know a comment or two. There was one woman in her high 80s that said, she stopped me after the show, and you know, I'll greet people and talk with them for a little bit. She looked right in my eyes, she said, "Lenny, you make people happy."
Yeah, that's a great way to end the show. I can't let you out of here without telling people if they'd like to hire you as an entertainer. How do they find out more about you?
Well, on Facebook, I have a Facebook page. It's called Lenny Zarcone Music and Entertainment.
Okay, and spell Zarcone for us.
Z like zebra, A-R-C-O-N-E.
One N, so they can find you, okay.
But also on my regular Facebook page, I put all kinds of things in all the time too. That's one way.
Okay. And they certainly could email.
They can't find they could my phone number,
though.
You know, someone tried to find my phone number to hire me, and
you
they couldn't
fix
reach
that.
Me. Yeah, I got to take care of
fix
that. Hey,
Lenny,
put it up in the credits.
Thanks for doing this, Lenny. We're out of time. I got to go. I'm the Money Doctor. Ending another show. Until our next chat, keep it positive. Thank you, Lenny.
There's a better life if I could be debt free. But all my money is a mystery. I was feeling overwhelmed and it was wearing thin. When I knocked on the door and heard the doctor's in. Well, the doctor's in, the doctor's in. She got the right prescription to help you win. Well, the doctor's in, the money doctor's in.